Hey guys, this is John with Greenfish Nation. I want to welcome you to the channel today. I really appreciate you giving me some of your time today. Guys, today we're going to be continuing our series, How to Become a Better Angler. Within this series, How to Become a Better Angler, we're going to have several mini-series. Today we're going to be starting a series. I'm not real sure exactly how many videos it's going to take to do this, but we're going to learn what there is to patterning bass. We'll learn the different types of patterns, seasonal patterns, monthly patterns, daily patterns, local patterns. So you guys stay tuned to Greenfish Nation for more about patterning bass for more success. Guys, when it comes to patterning bass, they are creatures of habit. Bass basically need three things. They need food, they need safety, and they need a place to reproduce. So those fish are going to seek those three items throughout their life, and they're going to evolve with however that changes. They're going to typically move when the bait fish move or their prey moves that they're eating. They're going to sort of move with that because, again, the one thing they have is food. The next thing they're going to have is safety. So as water levels fluctuate up and down, or predators move in or out of the area, they're going to do the same. They're always going to seek something that's going to be a safe place for them to survive. And they're also going to seek a good place in the spring of the year to spawn and reproduce. So those fish are going to be constantly moving throughout the year in conjunction with those three things. Guys, first thing I want to talk about with you is seasonal patterns. Just like we had mentioned, bass need the three things to continue their existence. They need food or forage. They need safety, shelter, ambush points. And they also need a place to spawn. With that being said, here we have four seasons. We have spring, we have summer, we have fall, and we have winter. Bass adapt to those seasons accordingly. Spring is broken down basically into three categories. You're going to have your pre-spawn, you're going to have your spawn, and you're going to have your post-spawn. Now, at different times, all three of those things can be happening on the very same piece of water, because lake levels are, you know, warming up at different times of the year. You know, you start warming more on your northern parts of the lakes here in Texas because they tend to be more shallow, more stained water, so they attract more heat. Your spawn will generally start there, and it'll kind of move throughout the lake all the way down to the southern end of the lake. You know, your bass will generally spawn down toward the what we call the down end or the south end of the lake on the majority of the lakes here in Texas last. But so those are kind of your seasonal patterns. Guys, let's talk about what happens first in the spring. You know, your fish, they've been setting out suspended, most of them in deeper water throughout the winter, only moving and eating when some bait or some food comes along that's really worth burning the calories for. Most of them are pretty lethargic, like I said, suspended up off the bottom. They're opportunity feeders. They're going to feed on something that's really worth moving. Other than that, they're going to let it go by. They're cold-blooded animals. Their metabolism slows down. Their heart rate slows down. Their oxygen conversion, it slows as well. They don't need as much oxygen. But so they're going to be opportunistic. But as that winter starts to close and they start, the sun starts being out longer, they're triggered to start thinking about reproduction. Those fish will move up out of those winter haunts and they'll start to hit those main lake points, especially been my experience. Anything that's got any kind of rock or timber type cover on it, those bait fish are gonna start schooling up, moving up there. Therefore, your bass are gonna follow. They're interested in getting their bellies full and getting up enough fat stores and energy for the spawn that's about to take place. So you can generally find those fish in the pre-spawn, like I said, moving up out of those deep haunts, up on the main lake points. If you can got a channel swing bank or a bank that's got a deep flat on it, 6 to 8 foot, you generally can find them there early in the morning and late in the evening pushing bait up. That's a good place to find some pre-spawn fish. Another good place is main lake humps. You'll have some humps out there that are, that come up out of 30, 40 foot of water. Come up to 6 to 8 foot deep, that's a good place for them to push and forage bait fish there as well. Then after that, we're gonna start thinking about the spawn. Those fish are gonna start moving back into the backs of coves, generally making stopping points along the secondary points, and then eventually moving back into the spawning flats. You'll find those fish depending on where you fish at. Well, hey, Chico. My buddy Chico joined us today. I don't know if you guys have ever seen Chico. He's a neighborhood mutt around here. He likes to sit out here and get patted on. But anyway, getting back to the fishing. So they want to move up into those secondary points and start staging up on the flats. The males will eventually start moving back into the backs of those flats and start making some beds and areas and try to start courting those females. You'll generally find most of those bigger females out still somewhere between that entry of that main lake point and that secondary point, eventually moving back to the spawning flats. And after you fish a spawn, it's just kind of a reverse. You're gonna start seeing those guys move out there back off of those flats to the first cover break, whether that be timber or boat docks, or they're gonna start setting up on some ambush points and start getting ready to filling back up and restoring their reserves for the summer. They're gonna be moving back and forth between the secondary and primary points out on the lakes. Creek channels are a good place to find those. Good summertime patterns start right after the spawn, late April, early May. We start throwing some slower moving baits. Like to throw some, pitch some jigs and just any kind of Texas rig or Carolina rig worm out there around on the main lake points. Anything that's going to be around a steep drop off or a quick descending bank is always pretty good at the mouths of some of these coves where you've got good spawning flats in the back. That's where I like to start. I've thrown deep diving crankbaits. I like throwing swim jigs. Also like throwing early and late. I'll get out there with a jerkbait even and do pretty good even in the summertime. Everybody likes to think that jerk baits are only good in the winter when the fish are slow and lethargic and you can fish them slow, but I like to fish them early and late all summer long. We do pretty good on them, especially when they're schooling. Chasing shad, you just have to present it a little bit different. Also throwing big glide baits around those points, and especially if you can find a shell bed, you can really do some good with a big glide bait around that shell bed early and late. Especially early, the shad will come up and spawn, and you can really, really successfully capitalize on some bigger fish in the morning times. Those summer patterns will continue all the way, through late August. The hotter it gets, the deeper we like to get on those main lake points. I like to get up on the point up next to the bank and cast out to the lake as far as I can cast, you know, like with a Carolina rig, and kind of work my way back up the point, back up from deep up to shallow. And then once I locate fish, I'll you know, change my presentation. I might move off to the side if they quit biting. Move off to the side, present it to them a different direction. A lot of times that'll help. Fish on the windy side of the point generally helps also, because it wants to push that bait fish up there. But then once, you know, the summer heat rolls around, mainly fishing late and early, seem to do better. Don't do a whole lot during the heat of the day. But then after August, September starts rolling around, we start looking at some fall patterns. Fish are chasing small bait fish in schools, early and late. They're good on top waters, anything from a little 2-inch tiny torpedo up to, you know, a 5 or 6 inch Zaraspook. Again, jerk baits are good for this as well. Fast moving jerk baits. Flukes and that sort of stuff. But those are some, you know, bait patterns that we have. Those fish are actually starting to push up from those main lake points and kind of push the bait fish back toward those secondary points, anywhere they can push them out of a creek or off of a deep area up onto a shallow flat where they can capitalize on them. That's always a good place to find those. Then you got your wintertime patterns. Those fish, they start moving back out to the deeper areas off of those main lake points. Generally here in Texas, you'll go from fishing, you know, the summertime, I like to be anywhere from about 8 to 15 or 8 to 18 foot of water. In the wintertime, I like to go anywhere from about 18 to about 30 foot. You seem to do pretty good there. Anytime you can find any type of structure or underwater cover, and there is a difference in those two. I'll go over that with you here in just a minute. But those are good for wintertime haunts, suspended fish, deep diving jerk baits work well, swim jigs. The infamous Alabama rig works good as well there. And, you know, any type of Carolina rig, almost dead sticking, that works well. But anyway, you guys stay tuned, and we're going to talk about the differences between cover and structure, and also introduce you to some of the tools that we use to find these fish, to develop patterns no matter what time of year it is. All right, guys, I want to talk to you about the difference in structure and cover. There seems to be some confusion about that. A lot of people call some things that are actually cover structure. But so structure is anything that is natural, or it can even be man-made, say like a road bed in a lake. That is structure. That never moves. You know, if you got main lake secondary points, as we talked about, those are structural features. Things like channel swing banks, that's structure. Flats, that's also structure. Steep rock ledges, that's structure. But a rock pile is cover. A boat dock is cover. Lily pads are cover. The shade of a bridge is cover. Even though the bridge is structure, the shade is considered cover. Anything that fish can hide in to create an ambush point, like grass, reeds, lily pads, those things that are seasonally changing, even timber out in the lake is considered cover. Well, guys, I hope this definition of cover and structure is a little more clear for you now. I put you some definitions up at the top there so you can look at those. You can feel free to screenshot those if you want to. But now we're going to talk about some of the tools that we use before we ever get on the water that help us become better fishermen. So you got to stay tuned for those tools. All right, guys, I wanted to talk to you about some of the pre-fishing tools that we use to figure out where we want to fish, depending on what pattern that we are trying to develop, whether that be summer, fall, winter, or spring. One of the most important tools that we use is Google Earth. If you guys are not familiar with Google Earth, you're really missing out on a key thing that you can do to become a better fisherman, to better understand structural and cover aspects of the lake. So let me show you a little bit here about Google Earth. I'm not going to go real in depth with it, but I am going to show you a lake that I have spent a few hours on marking some points of interest, or what I call high percentage spots. So you guys hang around and we'll look at those. All right, guys, we're going to look here at Google Earth. If I can get this thing in the camera like we want it here and still not hit the camera. So I've got Google Earth down here on my desktop. I'm just going to click on it. We're going to pull that dude up. Let it load here. Just take just a second. This is Google Earth Pro. You can go and upload this for free. It automatically is going to go to where I've got some things marked. I've got a couple of lakes that I'm working on right now. I've got Tuakini. I've got, I don't know how many waypoints on it, probably 250. And you can go and put these in your graph, whether you have a Lowrance or you have a Hummingbird. There's ways to put these in your graph. So let's go over here and let me just show you what we got here. So right here, I have got, this looks like a good little spot right here. Got two or three right here. Let me get this thing moved in where you guys can see it. So I have marked some rock piles right here, okay? So if you guys will look, I'm going to click right down here in this bottom left corner. And this picture is currently in 2021, October of 2021. That was the lake level. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to show y'all how I found these rock piles, because otherwise, unless you were a local fisherman and you knew about them, you'd just probably position your boat here, and throw at this bank here. You'd be sitting on the juice and not even know it, okay? So this is a picture from March of 2014. So what I did is, well, dadgummit, let's get out of this. Exit ground level. Went a little too far there, guys. So what I did is I went and I found points of interest here. As you can see, the water is way down in this picture. We're approximately, I'm gonna say, at least 100 yards from the original bank line. But if I go back to today's date, you can see that those rock piles are right out in the middle of nowhere. You would never know those were there if the lake was at normal pool. Show you guys some more things here, okay? This is in Squirrel Cove over on Tuakini. All right, this is another real good spot I've got marked here. I've got some spawning beds marked, and I'm just gonna blow those up for you guys. As y'all can see, they're not in a real deep part of the lake. This cove generally at full pool is about 4 foot deep at the deepest. So I'm gonna go back over here to my little arrow, and I'm gonna move this down to 2014. March of 14. You guys see all of those beds? Now, I'm sure there's some bass beds in there and there's some brim beds in there, but regardless whether it's bass or brim beds, the bass are going to be there eating the brim when they're spawning, and you know the brim are going to be tooling around there. Another thing you can look at is you can look at your creek arms. This is real important. You can pick out some areas, and I chose to just mark this where it had the most turns in it, but you could mark it all the way out down here if you wanted to. I'm sorry, I said this is in Squirrel Cove, guys. This is in Oak. This is Squirrel over here. There's a lot of good things over here as well. You can do these lake breakdowns yourself, or there's some guys out here on YouTube that'll do lake breakdowns for you, but I just seem to do them myself because I tend to find more spots than they do. But you could mark all of this creek, all these swings and this inside and outside turns in this creek. You can look at, here's a deep ditch right here that falls out into this creek. There's a junction right there. But guys, this is just one of the important tools that we use. It's endless on what you can do with this thing. You can spend hours. You can look here and see this is Tewakini. I've spent, like I said, a few hours going around and marking every little lay down, creek, tire, rip route points, deep holes, humps. There's a hump right over here that I've lived here and fished Tewakini my whole life, and I knew that this hump was there, but I did not know this one was there. All right, guys, some of the other important things that that we use in fishing, we hold them right here in our hand. This is our cell phone. I have several apps here. I'll just name them off. I've got the Deep Dive app. I usually keep a barometer on my phone. I have an app called Wind Finder. I have a Moon Phase app. I have a weather app, just a general weather app that comes on my iPhone. I have Fish Smart by Humminbird, and I have Navionics by Lowrance. I also have a GPS locator. I have a Fishing Times calendar, like a solar lunar calendar. And I have one that I just started using. It's called Lake Levels. You can use that to do the offset on your sonar, on your graph. And that will help you be a lot more accurate. So anything you can do to be more accurate is very helpful to you. So guys, let's look at this. We're gonna look at this Deep Dive app first. You guys have heard me talk about this app quite a bit. I'm gonna set my phone down actually here on my computer so you guys can see. So let's hang out for just a minute and we'll go over these apps. Okay, guys, I've got the Deep Dive app pulled up here on my phone. It's trying to go away on me there. I'm going to move this back just a little bit so you can see. Now, what this app does is it allows you to choose a lake. So if I want to change my lake, you can see I've got a few here marked as favorites. So if I decided that I wanted to fish, let's see here. Let's just go with Tewakini since that's what we started with. All right, it's going to choose my lake right up here at the top. Then the next thing is it's going to let me know the temperature, and it's going to be partly cloudy, 77 degrees. I have to agree with that. That's what I'm seeing, partly cloudy skies right now, and it's about 77, 78 degrees. I have my 0% chance of rain. And then the next one is CFS. That's the water that's going out of the lake. Currently right now, Tewakini is at zero. Tewakini is a lake that does not have a controllable floodgate. It basically has a spillway. We're in stable frontal conditions. And right now we have a south wind at 8 miles an hour that's gusting up to 14. Now, just knowing Tewakini, I know that generally most of your bass are going to be caught in less than 8 foot of water, so I'm going to go with a shallow water pattern. Tewakini is generally has anywhere from 0 to 2 foot of visibility, so I'm going to go with our water clarity is going to be dirty. Water temperature at Tewakini right now is 66 degrees. I am going to be fishing windy areas, and there is no actual aquatic vegetation at this time. So I'm going to be fishing down here. I'm going to choose sunrise. So if you look at this, I'm targeting largemouth bass. And these two little bars right here, one of them is the percentage of catch, and the other one is the ease of use, okay? So what it's doing is it's telling me to fish this square bill crankbait in 1 to 5 foot of water, which would be considered shallow, and in the back half of the creek. It also tells me a chartreuse with a black back is going to be my highest percentage color. Now, if I want to know more in depth about this lure, I can just click right here. So see here, you have effectiveness and ease of use, backed by real tournament intel. The deep dive strategy, that's not on every one, but most of them. So this is going to give you your location. Now, your lake may not look exactly like this, but it says, you know, your lake will look different. This is an example only. So this would be a creek right here, and it's telling you to fish it in the back half. So the type of structure you want to look for is you want to look for channel swing banks, flat banks, roads or bridges that are submerged, or shallow flats. And you can even break this down. Let's look at this channel swing bank. So it gives you a few examples of, you know, where to look for, you know, your channel swing banks or whatever. And you can break each one of these down and look at it. Now, as far as cover goes, remember we talked about different types, the difference in structure and cover. We would want to look for riprap, and it kind of gives you some picture examples, or some pea gravel flats, you know, like on some, around some swimming areas and stuff like that. Then the next bait is going to be a chartreuse willow leaf spinner bait, would be your next bait of choice. And then, as you can see, you go on and you can, it gives you a few different choices throughout the day, different times of the day, and you can even choose to go deep if you want to try to fish deep. Now see here on this lake, particular lake on this day, no strategies are available. But I can tell you from experience on Tuwakini, you're not going to catch any bass out deep. You're not going to get out there in 25 or 30 foot of water and catch bass on a regular basis. You might accidentally slip up on one or two now and again, but most of your strategies on Tuwakini are going to be shallow, 8 foot or less. And that's what I was talking about on your local patterns. If you know your lake's patterns, you're pay yourself dividends. So we'll move on to our next app there that we use, guys. We're going to move through these pretty quick. I just want to spend a little bit more time on that deep dive app. And I want to thank Intuitive Angling and Fish the Moment. They're the ones that turned me on to this deep dive app. Johnny Schultz, I think, played a major role in this deep dive app. He has the channel Fish the Moment. If you guys haven't checked out his channel and Randy Blockett's channel, Intuitive Angling, guys, those are two you should really plug into and check out. So we'll get into the rest of these apps when we get back. So you guys hang tight for more patterns with Greenfish Nation. All right, guys, the next app we use is Barometer, and it's pretty simple. You can set your barometric pressure. The current reading today is 29.26. The last time I took a reading, which I was a couple days ago, it was lower than that. So if you want to reset today's current, you just set that, and then you can keep an eye on it for the next day. That's our barometer. Then the next thing I've got, I really like this little app. It's called Windfinder. And you can choose your favorites. I have a little map button down here. I have several lakes that I fish here in the East Texas area. I have Hubbard, Tuwakini, and Fork marked, but you can look right here. You can see that we're all pretty much in the green, so we're looking anywhere from about 16 to 25 miles an hour, And you can blow these up if you want, just expand those with your fingers. And if you want to, you can always come down here to the bottom and you can go in 3-hour increments, or you can just slide it to the side and it tells you, you know, what the wind's going to be up into a few days. But guys, I've been using this for about a year and I found this thing to be pretty dadgum accurate. So you guys check that out if you haven't heard of Wind Finder. It's a good app. Let me get out of here. And then of course the moon phase, this gives you your location, and then you can actually slide this if you want to know that on April 16th at 1 p.m. in the afternoon you're going to be at 100% full moon at 1331. That's also going to give you your accumulation, your moon set, moon rise. It tells you the full moon is actually 0 days, 0 hours, and 24 minutes from this time. Tells you your new moon. There's just a lot of stuff on here, not a ton of advertisements, and that adjusts anywhere. You can pick different locations and all that. So then, you know, I just have a regular standard weather app. I'm in Mount Vernon right now, but you know, it gives you hourly and all that stuff. I think everybody's cell phone's got some kind of weather app. And then we got our Navionics here, got our Hummingbird here, and then this is a satellite GPS locator. I don't use this a whole lot fishing because I have that on my fish finder, but it's always nice to have it. If you want to send somebody a location where you're at and they have this, they can pull it up or whatever. This is a new app that I've started using. This one does have some advertisements, but they're not detrimental. This is just a lunar and solar calendar. It gives you your minor times. I'm sorry, your minor this way, the smaller ones, and then your major times. And it's also going to give you your sunrise, sunset. It actually gives you a daily rating, like today is a 2-star rating on fishing. And I've only used this about a month, but I really do like it. So I hope you guys will check this out as well. And the last one, I've only had this one just a few days. So if I want to look up Tawakoni, see if I can remember how to do this. Change, there we go. I'm just going to go down here to the T's, and I'm going to go to Tawakoni and click on it right there. It tells me the capacity level is 437.5 feet above sea level. Current elevation is 435.88. It's a difference of 1.62 feet from pool. 10-day gain, it's gained 7.32 inches in the last 10 days. We had 2.5 inches of rain about 40 miles north of us where the Sabine initially starts and it spills into Tawakoni. Last 24 hours, don't understand this, we've had 0.24 inches. Now, I don't know if that's how much we've gained. I'm assuming it is because the creeks are running but real slow. But anyway, I'm going to assume that's what we've gained. But guys, these are apps that I use that help me develop patterns for fishing. Guys, these are some of the tools that we use to make us better anglers. I really do appreciate you joining us today. I hope you guys will stay tuned for future episodes of the pattern development. Watch us get out on the water with those and actually put those together and put some fish in the boat. I want to thank you for joining us today. I want to thank everyone that has put these apps out. I'm not sponsored by anybody here, guys. If I find something that works good for me, I just want to share it with others to help everyone be a successful angler. But guys, if you haven't subscribed to our channel, it's right over there. You can click that little subscription button. I'd really appreciate it. And right there is that little bell. You can click that little bell. And give us a thumbs up if you like our videos. Tell somebody about us. You're our only advertisement, guys. I want to thank you again today for your time and joining the channel. Until next time here on Greenfish Nation, I'm your host, John, and I want to wish you guys tight lines.